Hello, I'm Helen Ferre. On today's program, remember the Boston Marathon hero, the guy with the cowboy hat? Whatever became of him? And to give is to receive, but how do you convince the young of that? City Year might have the answer. But first, the Miami Coalition of Christian and Jews recently held a panel titled, Can We Talk? Really, can we talk? Suggesting that although we herald our diversity as a great strength, we really don't embrace it. Or do we? The event was moderated by my next guest, Dave Lawrence Jr., president of the Early Childhood Initiative Foundation, very involved in everything doing with children and early education. He was also former publisher of the Miami Herald. Dave Lawrence, life after publishing has treated you well.
Well, I've been blessed. I've now been gone from the Herald as of January for 15 years.
How many?
15 years.
15.
And I still run into people who think I'm still with the Herald, et cetera. I love the Herald.
Which tells you something of how you've made a mark in the community. Yeah. But you've stayed really active. You're one of those people who retires but doesn't really retire. You make an impact every single
day. I think retirement is perilous to one's mental and physical health, so don't look for any retirement announcements from me.
Good. So, can we talk, Dave Lawrence, can we talk as a community? MCCJ held a wonderful event, and you guys are doing monthly conversations with the community. This one was particularly fascinating to me. Thank you so much for inviting me to be on that prestigious panel. Can we talk? Can we really talk? Suggest that even though we celebrate our diversity and we might think that we are very open and, a community, we're really not. What's missing? What did you learn from that panel? What do we need to know?
Well, I love this community. We've been here since 1989. We came from Detroit, another not particularly easy community, but a community we also loved. It was sort of like frying pan to the frying pan. Miami is the very future of America. We're at the cutting edge of American pluralism. This country is a very different country from any other country. We're at least trying in this country to understand these issues. But fact of the matter is we lead mostly very separate lives in greater Miami. We see each other at work. And I think we like each other at work, and we see each other in grocery stores, and I think we like each other in grocery stores. But one of my tests for people is, whom did you have in your home in the past half year or year? And it tends to be people like yourself.
Yes.
We are not going to fulfill the promise of this community or of this country if frankly, we spend most of our time with people who reinforce what's within us. We need to know some different people.
And one of the things that really, when you look at it, I don't think, we don't intend to be a segregated community, but we are. Language drives it to some degree. The Haitian community likes to be with the Haitian Creole-speaking community. Hispanics, you know, people would say, oh, please put me with somebody who speaks Spanish, even though they can speak English. It's looking for comfort, which is good, but you know, sometimes you're surprised.
Well, no one ought to live in Miami unless you want to participate in the great American adventure. If you're offended in going into Sedano's or Publix or Winn-Dixie or whatever, and they're speaking every language but your own, you probably ought to live somewhere else. But the truth of the matter is, you can't escape in America anymore. You may think you've escaped, but you're not escaping. This is the real America. There are lots of challenges in this community. Significant poverty, have and have nots. We've got stunning wealth and stunning poverty.
That's true.
Language is a challenge. I think a bigger challenge than language, frankly, is culture. We're in a community where more than half of us were born in another country. Mm-hmm. And we look at the world some differently. We've got an obligation to understand each other if we want to lead complete lives. And my children and grandchildren are going to grow up in that world. Better get used to it.
But you know what? I don't think a lot of people understand that we have that obligation. I think that sense of community is a sense, it's something that we've just modified to our own convenience. It's whoever lives within our gated community. It's whoever goes to our church. It's whoever goes to our children's school. And the schools, unless they're public schools or charter schools, are very segregated.
Well, so, and even public schools have significantly segregation.
According to zip code. I mean, you can tell the quality of a school very often by the zip code of that school.
Sure.
So how do we, you know, you talked about significant poverty. This segregation, self-imposed segregation, creates and contributes to that significant poverty.
Well, we live in a country where we have long bragged and taken great pride in anyone can do anything. I don't care how you were born, where you were born, etc. But here's the sad and painful truth that people are awakening to now. We do not have the social mobility we used to have. You have folks at one end, the rich getting really, really rich, not just rich, really, really rich. 25% of the children in this community and in this country grow up in the full federal definition of poverty, in the richest, most generous country in the world. I'm not for income redistribution. I'm not a socialist. I'm not for nanny state, but you ought to be scared that people don't have the access to growing in every way that we have long prided ourselves in America.
It's so interesting that you could talk about the lack of social mobility, and without getting into the politics of it all, what you're saying, and you're very centrist, is something that Jeb Bush said, and he's considered a conservative. But Jeb Bush said that a month ago as well. We don't have social mobility like we did before. That is perilous to our democracy.
And education, Jeb Bush would say, a man I much admire, Jeb Bush would say education fundamentally is the answer, and that's why I spend my time on early childhood. We also have a hell of a problem in this country, whether it offends people or not, in basic old-fashioned racism.
Yes.
And we're not in any kind of post-racial society, and you can see the dynamics all around. Yes, we have made specific progress in laws changing, but for us to progress further, we need to confront ourselves. Every bit of crap in people's souls, including my own, it was learned, it was acquired. We weren't born with it, certainly, in God's world.
So how do we challenge ourselves? This is Thanksgiving weekend. How do we challenge ourselves to understand our community better? And we've talked about, we're actually a more generous community than people know. We're actually philanthropically well endowed. And I know that Give Miami Day, your foundation, you know, Children's Trust.
Movement.
Why don't you tell the story?
Well, it was a remarkable moment. I'm a big fan of the Miami Foundation, the old Dade Community Foundation. It's now run by Javier Soto, was run before by Ruth Shack, another gifted public servant in this community. And Javier had a vision, let's make one day, and got 400-plus organizations to compete for this. And every donation made that day had at least a partial match. It was highly competitive, lots of fun, lots of good done, and raised $3.2 million, which is about three times as much as the first year, which was last year. And 397 people gave to the children's movement, which I would brag this little bit was more contributors than any other of the 400 organizations. And some people gave $25 and $50 and $100 and whatever else. God, it was a great moment for the community, and lots of good will be done.
And this is something that we were talking about, that we don't realize or want to salute the fact that we have great and wonderful things in our community. How do we change ourselves? You talked about challenging the self. This is Thanksgiving week. How do we challenge ourselves to open up and to recognize? You had a great challenging question. Who have you invited in the last 6 months or in the last year to your home who is out of your comfort zone, different, somebody new doesn't look like you?
H.T. Smith, who's a person I much admire in this community, said last week words to the effect of, we love diversity, but we don't live it. And yes, some people do much better than others and so forth. When I ran newspapers, I insisted that people get out of the office. You can't learn anything in the office.
That's right.
What are you reading that challenges yourself? What kind of history and biographies? What are you learning? Did you go to the book fair? Whom did you meet? Yesterday I spent the morning with people working with significantly challenged children. God, it was humbling to me to see this and how much people care and how much people are working together. There are stunning instances, but you're not going to find it out by being only with people like yourself. It's just, you cannot fulfill the fullness of this country without reaching out in significant ways. Beyond my own family and my own faith, the great joy of this world, frankly, is learning. And the best people I know are learning all their lives. And what else do you know about Miami? It's the biggest small town in the United States. Insult no one, because within 18 hours you're going to find they're related to whomever. But that's the joy of Miami, knowing different people, figuring it out. You want to run an institution, a nonprofit, a business, or whatever, you need to know relationships. This is a small town. That's the beauty of it.
And that's the beauty of it. And just very quickly, at the MCCJ event that you moderated, you presented some clips of the movie Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, which you were right. I mean, I'd forgotten, but it was really scandalous in its time. Sidney Poitier was the black gentleman, fiancé to this prestigious
white
family.
Born in Miami, not incidentally.
Born in Miami, and his future father-in-law was a newspaper publisher who thought he was liberal.
A crusading newspaper publisher,
Spencer Tracy. He looked familiar to me somehow.
Spencer Tracy, and there is this extraordinary scene. This is 1967. We're in the middle of riot, rebellion, insurrection. A time of assassination, a time of Vietnam. This is really tough time. These are really tough times in this country. And there's a scene on the wealthy newspaper publisher's patio in which he and Sidney Poitier are having a conversation, and Spencer Tracy is saying to his prospective son-in-law, "My God, man, have you thought about having children when you married our daughter, this white woman?" And Sidney Poitier basically, responds to it and then goes on to say, "I can't imagine a marriage without children." And more than that, my wife thinks our children could grow up to be president of the United States. Well, I get a little chill myself, because 40 years later, a black man does grow up to be president of the United States. We've made some gains. We got a long way to go. We still need to think about Guess Who's Coming to Dinner and then make it happen.
Very true. Dave Lawrence, thanks so much for joining me today.
I love being here. Thank you for having me.
Up next, Michael Mayo catches up with the Boston Marathon hero, Carlos Arredondo. Stay with us. Cowboy hat wearing Carlos Arredondo is best known for being photographed rushing in to help the victims of the Boston Marathon bombing in April. But in South Florida, he may be remembered as the grieving father who set his van on fire after learning about the death of his son, who was killed in Iraq. Michael Mayo, columnist at the South Florida Sun Sentinel, caught up with Arredondo and is here to tell us more. Good to see you, Michael.
Hey, Helen. Thanks for having me.
You know, this is a fascinating story. It's true. We know different sides of him. And after this hero jumps in to save the lives of others, He's almost like disparaged immediately in media, like he, as if he's a kook in a way. And he's just amazing. What drove you to do this story?
Well, what drove me is that the day after the bombings, when we saw this photo that was being widely distributed and made it to newspaper front pages all over the world, he was ID'd as Carlos Arredondo. And that name immediately registered in my mind, because when he had that incident following the death of his son Alex, who was killed in the Iraq War, and then Carlos had his visceral response by burning the Marine van, that was in Hollywood, Florida. I covered that story. I wrote columns about it in the aftermath, and I got to know Carlos and his wife Melita. And so when I saw his name, I was like, "Oh my God, that's Carlos!" And he became a prominent anti-war activist after the that whole van incident too. But I called the cell phone number that I had for him that day, and I was able to get through, and he was getting bombarded with things. And I just started up, I wrote something at the time, but then I thought, this guy's whole life story, between not only losing his son Alex in the Iraq War, but also then he lost another son, Brian, to suicide in the aftermath of the war. I said, wow, this there's more going on here that really deserves kind of a closer look. So fortunately, my editors were on board and say, yeah, this might make for a good profile. And, several trips to Boston over the last few months later, along with my great photojournalist colleague, Michael Laughlin, here we were, and we ended up with a full 10,000-page, 8-page special, 10,000-word, 8-page special section that published in the Sun Sentinel this past Sunday. But it's online now in perpetuity, thank goodness, for the internet.
Sentinel.com.
Sunsentinel.com/BostonCarlos for people who might want to spend some time reading this full life story.
And so Boston Carlos is who? Well, who is this guy?
Who is this guy? He's a human being. And
so complicated, like all of us are.
Like all of us. And that's kind of what I thought really made his story alluring, is he's kind of, in a way, his Melita, who's now his actually second ex-wife, but they're still partners and they still live together, but they've gone through a divorce as well. But she calls him the Latino Forrest Gump, because basically his life story, he's been involved in all these major news stories and issues and sweeping things of his day. And he came to this country from Costa Rica when he was just 20 years old. He crossed the border at Mexico to Arizona, so he was an illegal immigrant, if you want to use that term. And then he made his way to Boston. He started a life and found a wife and had two kids, but then he went through a whole upheaval, divorce, and a lot of people can relate to that. And then he ends up being involved with losing a son in the Iraq War, and that was obviously a big contentious issue. And then he ends up finds himself in the middle of a terrorist event, the Boston Marathon bombing this year, and what he did that day, he had a decision to make, and he did something that a lot of people found heroic. He rushed into the chaos. He ended up saving this severely injured young man, Jeffrey Bauman, and now the two of them have formed this bond where they go around in New England together as special appearances, and they just came back. They spent a week together in Costa Rica on a vacation where their families and just kind of hanging out. So it's that part of it is a neat story. But he's a complex, flawed human being. I think, like his life story, people can kind of relate to a little bit of maybe everything that he's gone through in their own lives.
How did the Boston Marathon bombing change him?
Well,
does he know?
It changed him. I think it's given him a new role in that. What I write about is he's become this unpaid ambassador where he goes around to all these events. He's known as basically this, this figure who I call him Mr. Boston Strong, because he's kind of come to embody the whole resilience of the city with everything that he's been through in his past and then what he did that day. And I call him a teddy bear for a recovering city to hug. And he's been, rewarded with, he goes out, people recognize him, he gets his meals comped, he people want to photograph him, he gets invited to all these different cool charity events and goes to ball games.
Has he gone to his head?
No, and that's the thing. He's very grounded. His purpose now, he doesn't want to be a hero or a celebrity. He just wants to still make, he wants to be out there advocating for certain causes, like veterans' rights and the different benefits for military families, and now also with suicide awareness and also mental health and mental illness, because he himself now has been diagnosed with mental illness, is on medication, and he's pretty upfront about all of this.
Just connect the dots for us. He was in South Florida.
Right.
When you covered the story, when he finds out that his son has died at war, and he sets fire to the Marine van.
Yeah.
The Marine van.
He had come from Boston. He's gone back and forth several times.
So he has family here.
He doesn't have family here. No, his actually, Melita, his second wife, has family that were down here. They still live down here in South Florida.
So, yes. But basically, Boston is his home.
Boston has been his home. He had a couple of stints down here. If you read the story, he kind of tried to start over after his first breakup, first marriage dissolved. Him and Melita came down here to kind of start fresh. Then he went back to Boston. Then he came back here. So, you know, like a lot of people from the Northeast, they kind of go back and forth depending on circumstances.
One last question to you. As a journalist, what do you learn from Carlos Arredondo? Carlos Arredondo. It didn't even dawn on me, but that's actually the way most people would know him.
Yeah.
What do you learn from him?
I learned from him just that human beings can be amazingly resilient. And even though you don't, as a parent, I can't imagine even losing one child, much less two. And yet somehow he's found a way to still go on. Obviously he has his ups and his downs. But this, you know, at a moment of truth, and despite all the things that he's done in the past, all the mistakes he's made, and maybe he wasn't the best guy in his past, but at the moment of truth, he made the right decision, and he ended up helping save somebody else's life. And, you know, that's all you can ask from somebody is at a moment of truth, are they going to do the right thing? And when it counted, he did the right thing.
You know what? That's a great way to look at Carlos. Michael Mayo, once again, the website is?
sentinel.com/BostonCarlos. And thanks for having me on.
Congratulations on a great story. Up next, one South Florida organization is helping others give back to their community through education. Stay with us. City Year is a national organization that encourages young men and women between the ages of 17 and 24 to give back one city year volunteering at local schools. Joining us to explain this is Saif Ishouf, Executive Director of City Year Miami. Saif, good to see you.
Good morning, Helen. It's an honor to be here with you.
Oh, are you kidding? It's an honor for us to have you. So, you know, how do you convince someone between the ages of 17 to 24 that this is a good investment?
I think that we really don't have to convince them. The truth is, the millennial generation, these young people, I posit that they rival Tom Brokaw's generation as really being the greatest generation.
Really? I mean, that's not what you hear. You hear that, you know, very closed off, technology drives that, but they're not?
No, I mean, and the data shows it. So national service programs like City Year, we are an AmeriCorps program. We know that the data shows that for every one person that's being admitted to a program like City Year, you're having anywhere between 5 to 8 applicants. Our country last year said no over 1 million times to young people who want to serve. And that's primarily because we need to really think about how it is that we're creating platforms for engagement for national service opportunities like what we do at City Year.
So in other words, you're overwhelmed with people wanting to come in.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think that what we're discovering is that young people are seeing, and families, because I think it's a joint decision, particularly when we consider that City Year is unbelievably diverse. So young families, ethnic families, Hispanic families, where these decisions about what young people do post-college is sort of a communal decision. We're seeing that young people are realizing that if they do a year of service, it can connect them with many of the leadership skills they need to be successful in the workforce, to be successful leaders, and to be the type of active citizens that our country so desperately needs.
Okay, that's one measurement of success, getting young people to serve. But how do you measure on an educational level? While these guys are being groomed, are they being groomed at the expense of the children they're teaching?
No, absolutely not. I mean, I think one of the powerful things about the City Year model, where we recruit these amazing 17 to 24-year-olds, we challenge them and we resource them to be able to give a powerful year of service. and really creating a graduation pipeline. And that's what our work has been focused on over the last 25 years, and more specifically in the last 5 years. So we know by the data, according to Johns Hopkins University, that if you provide a second set of caring adults into a schoolhouse and you laser sharp their focus on attendance, behavior, and course performance in math and English, that they can dramatically increase the likelihood of students' ability to stay in school and on track. And here in Miami, as we know, we have transformational leadership from Superintendent Carvalho. And the superintendent recognized, as part of his broader transformation strategy, that there was a need that young adults could play, and there's a role that young adults could play. And like everything that's happening as part of this Miami Miracle in Education, it's all data-driven. So we know, for example, Helen, that last year, at the end of year course exams, that the students that Cityear worked with in freshman algebra scored 15% higher on their end of course exams than those students that didn't have an opportunity to have Cityear present. So we know via the data that our work is making an impact, and we know it's possible because of the broader fabric of an all-in philosophy of core members partnering with amazing teachers, faculty members, principals, and of course the public policy leadership of a district that is razor-sharp focused in making sure that every student in this community has the opportunity and resources in which to succeed.
Saif, you went to, you're a Harvard graduate. You could have done anything with your life. Why did you choose Cityear, or did Cityear choose you?
So I actually am a Georgetown grad.
No disrespect to Harvard.
No disrespect to Harvard, although I am wearing red, not quite crimson.
I have to say, you know what? A Jesuit education's a great thing.
Absolutely, absolutely. And so, you know, my family is the quintessential American immigrant family, and I recently lost my father, and he was a British military officer and an American entrepreneur here in Miami. And he said something to my sisters and I, which I carry with me, which is the belief that we honor the American dream by helping others achieve it. And for my sisters and I, and for my family, I see that. My sister's an OB-GYN who works in this community, primarily focusing her practice on young women who need that extra help of prenatal interventional help. And I see that every day in the core members who serve at Cityear. So for me, I was a technology entrepreneur and a lawyer, and I had this amazing opportunity to attend a Cityear event, and it grabbed my imagination. For many of us in this community that have an immigrant heritage, or those of us who are local, we recognize the need to build one community. And that's only going to happen not only through infrastructural investments, by investing in human capital. And that primarily is what Cityear is able to do. It's the human capital of the over 400,000 students in Miami-Dade County Public Schools. And it's also the human capital of getting these amazing young leaders, 17 to 24-year-olds, that recognize that they have a role to play. And the truth is, we all have a role to play. The government has a role to play with AmeriCorps. School district leaders like what we have with the amazing superintendent have a role to play. Philanthropy has a role to play. And young people have a role to play in addressing the issues of the next generation, which is coming right after them.
Saif Yashuf, I'm sorry for the loss of your dad, but I know he's smiling proudly at this moment.
Thank you. Thank you, Helen.
And I'm Helen Ferre, thanking you for watching. See you next time.